Wake up to reality. Listen.
Warrior class, Zoo, stand up. Warrior class, Zoo, show up. Warrior class, Zoo, rise up. Black power, everyone. I'm having a rough go at it, so just bear with me. You know I ease into it. I'm not one, like I said before, I'm not one with a bunch of words, so you know who I am by this time. You know I get a little word savvy a little bit, and sometimes I fumble my words. But at the end of the day, it's just really just trying to make sure that the message is always constantly being out there. I want to be that beacon of interpretation so that when you hear it, you're really hearing what you're supposed to hear, what you were meant to hear. As you can tell, class is in session. Come on and get into class. Come on and put those headphones on. Go ahead and play me around your children. Go ahead and play me around your friends and family. It's okay. This is a secret, but this is only a secret for those who understand the message. Other than that, this is the message that's supposed to get out to everyone. And when this message finds the heart of the warrior will know what to do as soon as the warrior hears this message. But if you're trying to play this message as it's supposed to be like something sacred to yourself, then by default, you in violation. This message should not be played for other nationalities. I'm a black man. I represent the nation of foundational blackness. This message is not supposed to be played for white people. This message is not supposed to be played for Hispanic people. This message is not supposed to be played for those that have the possibility to infiltrate and undo all that we are trying to do, which is to fix our nation. I said in one of my videos once before, you have to be weary and leery of men and women that look like you. The saying goes, not all skin folk are your kin folk. You have to understand what that means. That doesn't mean relatives solely. It doesn't mean cousins solely. It doesn't mean brothers and sisters solely. What it means is somewhere along the line, at a time before us, someone that looks like us came amongst us and started to undo, copy, mimic, infiltrate what we were doing. And what has happened is from that inception, you haven't been able to get them out because you don't know who they are, what they're about. Same thing goes with the story of ancient of old. In the original time, some of us were doing something a specific way. This is where the culture comes into play. We were doing something. Our ancestors were doing something in a specific way. Something that every other living group or civilization or culture were not doing. Same thing as if I have a brother, he does what he wants to do, I do what I want to do. When my brother does what he wants to do, in a nutshell, that serves his purpose, his family, his friends, his whatever. What I want to do serves my purpose, my family, my friends, the whatever. The only real reason it's going to be an issue is if I look at my brother and I see that he has a good life. He doesn't go through the trials and tribulations as an adult. He doesn't go through all the turmoil. He's not being harassed by police officers. He's not being this by that. What's going to happen is I'm going to look at him and I'm going to ask the question, well, how come you're able to get all these things and I'm not? My brother may tell me and my brother may not tell me. But by default, we already know what's going to happen. I'm going to get jealous. And if I get jealous, I'm a plot, I'm a scheme, plan, I'm going to try to figure out what it is that he's doing specifically that gives him whatever it is that he has that I want. Remember, I'm never going to really try to give you people's names. Not until I have to. When you look at the name, you associate the behavior only with the person demonstrating or exhibiting the behavior. So then it becomes dismissive because you're going to say and you're going to use the statement, well, that's just him. That doesn't mean all of them are doing it or all of us are doing it. That's how excusatory you guys are. You explain away everything and you make excuses for everything, but the behavior remains the same. I cannot stress this enough. This is why you have to go to class. And then oftentimes, even though you may say, well, I heard that before, doesn't matter how many times you heard it. What are you doing to offset it? What are you doing to stop it? You brushed your teeth before. Do you just brush your teeth one time and stop? Or do you do it, you know, routinely to prevent plaque from building up? Well, in order for me to say what I'm saying, changing the terminology, but the behavior remains the same, is so that you can understand it in all its forms. And I'm going to do it over and 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 over. I'm going to do it over and over again. There is no number on it. What's most important is that when I say it, you begin to hear it. You begin to understand it. Same thing one of my elder teachers says, you learn through participation or observation. You learn through participation or observation. So if you learn through participation, that was Huey P. Newton that said you learn through observation or participation. What does that really mean? You can sit on that porch all you want and look at the hustlers, the movers and the shakers and the bakers, those that are getting in and getting out, all you want, and think to yourself that you can do what they do. Understand that. You can sit, you can quarterback from the couch all you want, and think that you would have thrown that ball a little bit further, a little bit more on point. You can think all you want. That's the observation. But at some point, you're going to have to participate. And if you're not going to get on that football field, a football field, and actually learn how far you can throw a ball, learn how accurately you can throw the ball, then in a nutshell, you're not able to really bring to fruition your thought, your observation. You learn by participation and observation. The problem is that the blacks, foundational blacks, the originals, someone's infiltrating your ranks and you don't know how they're doing it. You don't know how they're doing it because in the essence, you're not willing to come to class. And in essence, the world has been structured to the point where you really, really don't have to come to class. Not until you get to a level that I'm at. And when you get to a level that I'm at or higher, what you realize is you're being hunted. If you're not at the level I'm at or higher, you don't realize you're being hunted. You're going to look at it and say, well, that particular person is not bad. That particular person is not good. You're not going to look at the support system behind that person. That's the way you guys talk. This is why you guys use the terminology, the fences, not every and not all. But you, in the other breath, say that you don't judge a person simply by the person, you judge them by the group. So if the group of people are moving against you, would you or would you not think that that one person is going to move against you too? This is the reason what I'm saying. You got to learn the talking points. You got to learn how we got here. So if you're sitting here and you're saying, all right, hurry up and get to the point. The reason why the video takes a little bit longer than me just giving you barbershop talk is because the video is deliberately designed to try to take my time to make sure, one, I stay on topic. I may use 6,000 examples, but I'm trying to use 6,000 examples to illuminate one point. I will not jump from 7 different points. Man, we ain't got enough time. Man, you got to do this. You got to do that. If you ever come to me and you ask me to speed it up, that is a violation. You don't understand. So this is the essence of getting you to understand. You have been taught speed. Everything you do has got to be quick, got to be fast, got to be Same thing in elementary. Those that are teachers that are hearing my voice, those that are pupils that are hearing my voice, those that are administration hearing my voice, you understand what I'm saying. You've gotten used to things being fast. Yeah, I know. I heard that before. Yeah, I understand what you're saying. Yeah, get to the point. If you're rushing me and this is class, you can rush me at work. We got to get back to work. We got to clock in and get back to work. I understand you're rushing me and we're walking down the street and the bus is getting ready to come and we're going in 2 different directions. You got to have him get on this bus and you want to get the conversation quick. I got it. But this is class. And class is designed deliberately to be 30 minutes to an hour. Anywhere between 30 minutes to an hour. As you may see, I chose not to show my face today because I explained to you there are going to be times where I don't show my face and I will show an avatar. I'm not an individual that needs you to see my face. I want to be seen. The reason why I cover that base in the beginning is because I want to explain to you, if that male or female does not have a track record of showing who they are, that is an indication that they're not really that serious. And you must be weary. You must be leery of why the individual wants to participate but doesn't want to be recognized. You have to understand, you have been taught a coward's language. You have been taught a coward's language and you think it's right. I just put a candy in my mouth, a Halls in my mouth. So that's why you hear my octave change. Listen. Today's topic is coward talk. I'm always showing you, the only thing I speak is one language. And that's the language of the separation, unification. I don't speak the language of play. I don't speak the language of just a little bit longer. I don't speak the language of one more time. I don't speak the language that someone else is going to fix it. I don't speak any other language but unity and separation. For anybody that thinks that you can come up out of this by incorporating other nations, by incorporating other nationalities, in a nutshell, you are a fool. 400 years ago, when you were getting your backside torn, beat up, thrashed, it would have made sense to think that if more white people realize that we are human too, then more white people would treat us better. I got it. You spent the last 400 plus, not 400, you're on the better half of 450. You're on the better half. You're actually around the 5,000, around the 6,000 plus mark. You are around the 6,000 plus mark of being a slave, of being in some form of bondage. You are around the 6,000 plus mark, year mark, of people exploiting you, mistreating you. So even though we use that terminology 400 years, is really not an exact number. It's just an indication that it's been a long time. And if you guys are reading the things that you say you're reading, if you're doing the studies that you say you're doing, you would know you can't come out of this with the help or assistance of any other nation. You would know that. Some of you guys are spiritual. Some of you guys are religious. Some of you guys are scientific. Some of you guys, you know, are historians. Understand what I'm saying? You had historians before you. They didn't bring you up out of it. You had archaeologists before you. They didn't bring you up out of it. You had religions before you, and they didn't bring you up out of it. You've had everything before us, 2020, and none of them brung us out of it. The only thing that any of them have really, really done is show you, the audience members, the pupils, how we were put in this position. And if you want to know how to come out of this, you can only come out of this one way. You can't come out of this in a manner of there's more than one way to skin a cat-ism. You can only come out of this one way. There has been mulattoes. There's been biracials. There's been mixed breeds. There has been multicultural relationships for as long as the humankind can remember. None of that has brought you out of your bondage. There has been gatekeepers. There has been boule. There has been all sort of mechanisms under whatever terminology it is for that particular season. Remember, it's a season of the flavor. Baskin-Robbins got 31 flavors. And I'm saying the same thing. They changed the name, but it's still ice cream. So if that's ice cream, which is a delicacy, which is a treat, which is ice, which is a sweetness, which is a food, imagine what they got when it comes to real life white supremacist systems and structures. Slavery. No matter where you're at on this rung, it has not brought us out of here because you, slaves, have not done one thing. Please stop getting emotional and listen. You have every right to be afraid of white people. You have every right to be afraid of Hispanic people. You have every right to be afraid of all nationalities and nations, including our own. You have every right. Everyone has participated in our misery. Everyone has conspired in our misery. And everyone has exploited our misery, and everyone is benefiting from our misery. Every. The question is how do we make it stop? Everything else is not important. Everything else is a way in order to stay within your misery a little bit more enjoyable. The only question that needs to be asked is how do we make it stop? Every day, sun up to sun down, Sunday through Sunday, 365, 247. The only question that should be asked is how do we make it stop? How do we end our suffrage? How do we end our bondage? That should be the only question. And every living being should be moving in the direction of making it stop. If somebody is sitting up here trying to engineer a car, that person is in violation. Well, I understand what you're going through, but I think that if if we make this card, your life would be a little easier. Off with your head. If somebody is around there learning how to split an atom, instead of trying to make sure that the black man, the black nation is no longer in any form of bondage, of misery, that person is in violation. You cannot make statements that says help those that need the most amount of help until they no longer need the most amount of help. These are the messages and statements that they say. Your oppressor says this. So if your oppressor says help those that need the most amount of help until they no longer need that amount of help, you have to ask yourself, then why are they not helping you? Your oppressors are saying they send you to war because of tyrants. They send you to war because the people are mistreating other people on foreign soil. This is what they're telling you. So if they're sending you to war on foreign soil, if they're sending you to war because of tyrants, people are mistreating other people, why would you return home to your mother country, to your country, where you are being treated either the same or worse than the people you went to go rescue? You have to understand, none of that is going to get you out of this. None of it. All those things are mechanisms and devices and instruments that allow you to suffer your suffrage better, more complacent, which ultimately means you're really not going to fight back. Well, how did we get here? I mentioned earlier in this video that way back when, one of us wasn't necessarily doing everything perfect. It's just that whatever we were doing, it was more beneficial to us. We didn't have to worry about famine. We didn't have to worry about being cold. We didn't have to worry about disease. We didn't have to worry about this, that, and the third. When the outsiders were looking at us, those are the people on the porch. When the outsiders was looking at us, they could not determine what was the deciding factor. What was the difference? What was the core reason why we are not dealing with the things that they're dealing with? Now, what you're going to have a problem is with history and with archaeology. You all want to find out who was the first. Who was the first? I'm not going to tell you that answer doesn't exist, because we know it exists. But I'm not going to be able to tell you when you're going to get that answer. I am going to answer you this way. We weren't the first. We were just the best. And I'm going to answer you like this. A lot of the people say, well, why would he choose? Why would he choose one over the other? Listen to me. They can't answer the question because they're indoctrinated. And when you're indoctrinated, you only go according to the information. When you're white, when you're indoctrinated, that means all things white. When you're counter-indoctrinated, that means all things black. When you're counter-indoctrinated or indoctrinated, you pretty much only go with the information. I am staying on topic. I'm talking about coward talk. You want to know who, what, when, where, why, and how. And I'm showing you who, what, when, where, why, and how. When the ancients, when the ancestors was doing whatever it was that they were doing, those that were not doing whatever it was that they were doing was angry, was jealous. What I gave you the example is the first. We are not the first. However, we are the best. It's like an experiment. No, I'm not going to use that one. I'm going to go to you like this. It's like buying a pet. When you buy a pet for the first time, you know it's a learning experience. So you don't put much into it. You know to feed it. You know to take it to the vet. For the most part, you good. You know the simples, the basics. However, when you get a little bit more information and you get a little bit more study and you start talking to people that have more experience than you, then you start to really, really hone in on what it is you're looking for in this pet. So when you go get your second or third pet, you're going to go there and you're going to go, I want a pit bull. And they're going to, well, why? Now you got the better understanding to say, because I want a protection dog. I want a dog that's loyal. I want a dog that's obedient. I want a dog that's a, you know, fast learner. I want a dog that's agile. Before you went and picked out that dog, do you not realize you've already chose for that dog to have the best of the best, to be the best of the best? This is where the experiment come into play. If I'm creating something, I'm creating it for an intended purpose. And since I don't really know, or I haven't experienced all the trials and tribulations associated with it, I don't necessarily say I choose it. I'm inventing it. I'm creating it. I'm making it. Same thing they do with prototypes. You got prototype one. You make it. You see how it functions. You see if it's durable. You see if it's sustainable. It either will be or it will not be. Then it sends you back to the drawing board. But remember, you chose it to be whatever it is you chose it to be before it came into existence. That's how you become the best. See, because, and that's how you can make a choice. Even though you've been shit the whole time, you're my chosen because I chose you. No matter what, all I need you to do is to fulfill what it is I chose you to do. I used to own a Doberman Pinscher, and that dog was a smart dog. It was skittish, but it was a smart dog, and it was a very, very, very immensely obedient dog. I didn't have to do a whole lot of this and a whole lot of that. By default, you got to do certain things to reel it in. But once it hit like year number two, I didn't have a problem out of that dog. Doberman Pinscher. Black and rust, black and tan. I could walk down the street where I live at, and there were children. And that dog would walk down the street ahead of me a couple of paces. All I had to do was call its name with no leash. If it got a little too far, all I had to do was call its name with no leash, no whistle, no nothing. And that dog would come walking right back. And he did it over and over for like 8 years. I didn't have the dog long because it got sick with some other stuff. But what I'm explaining is, if you're already chosen, all you need to do is measure up. That's all you need to do. However, you're not measuring up. But you are the best. What was put in you was the best of the best of the best of the best. At the same time, because you're not the first, there were others that look like you, but they are not you. All kinfolk, all skin folk ain't kinfolk. Please remember what I'm saying and take your time. Take your time to listen. This is the purpose of class. Class is in session. I'm taking my time so that you have enough time to absorb what I'm saying. You're not rushed. No one's talking over you. No one's doing this. If you're exercising, if you're jogging, if you're running, if you're working on a job, it's a video so you can play it back. And you can hear it word for word. You are not the first, you're the best. And you were chosen way before you did something good or way before you did something bad. And when that created you because of the other experiments, they can see where they did right or they can see where they did wrong. And when it came to you, they made sure none of that was an issue. And it wasn't. Until. There's always an until. And it wasn't until. And I bring to you ancient or historical things, and I try to show you how it's happening right now in modern day times. If you are on that street, if you are participating in the street life, or you have a cousin or a friend or a brother, if you're participating in that street life, certain things are happening in that life to where you who are not participating in that street life are going to look at the two lives and say, well, I don't want to go through all that they're doing because the street life is a dangerous life. However, you are definitely looking at the money. You're definitely looking at the fashion, the clothes, the culture. You're definitely looking at the way that the women, the females react to those men that are in that lifestyle. You are looking at least those things. And what happens is when you compare apples to oranges, your life to theirs, you're going to say, well, that's the only reason why they got what they got. You guys remember the commercials. Man, I made more in one day than you made in a whole year. Man, your dad ain't man. He ain't no man. He ain't making no money. I made $50,000 last week alone. How much you make, old man? How much you make on your job working for the white man, old man? Those are the things they used to say. It was in the movies. It was in real life. Understand what I'm saying. So when you get that and you look, but you're not a part of that game, you're going to try to find a way in. You're going to ask your cousin to put you down. You're going to ask your best friend to put you down. Remember, you're not a part of that life, but you're also tired of being broke. So when you're tired of when your level of tired of being broke is a little max, you're going to go over there and you're going to do this, that, and the third. But remember, you sat on the porch studying. Now you got the tattoos. Now you got the gold fronts. Now you got the cornrows. Now you got the baggy clothes and or whatever. But remember, that's not you. Now you're able to infiltrate. So when you infiltrate, do you realize that because it's not you, you are not going to be able to handle that lifestyle the way that those others are? Those dudes can handle that lifestyle. They can get in there and they can put in that work and come out and not think twice. When you get in there and you put in that work, you go like, man, I didn't want to do that. I thought it wasn't like that. And that man says, all right, you got to go over there and you got to talk to the dude on so-and-so and so-and-so because money is missing. Okay, well, what if so-and-so and so-and-so break loose? Well, they're going to give you a tool to tighten them up. And you're going to look at them and you're going to look at that tool and you go like, man, I hope it don't get that far because I don't want it to get that far. Well, when you go over there, homie's going to do whatever you got to do, stay in his ground. You're going to have to bring out that ratchet, that screwdriver to tighten them up. You're the type that doesn't really like that. Not only do you not like that, you also don't like the way that your people look as a reaction to being in that life. You don't belong over there. So what happens is you try to find a way out. Some of you try to find a way out. Some of you try to find a way deeper in, but not having to do as much grimy stuff. Everybody's different. But remember, this isn't you. What happens is that's the real world. Now let's go back to an ancient time. In ancient time, you guys, our ancestors was doing whatever it was that they were doing, but it was benefiting them. And when the skin folk that aren't our kinfolk started to mingle amongst us, they started to undo what we were doing. They started to undermine. Well, why are you praising this? Well, why are you dressing like that? Well, why are you wearing that? Well, why are you eating this? Well, why are you eating that? Well, why aren't you eating this? Well, why aren't you eating that? They infiltrated. And when they infiltrated, it pretty much put us in a position to where we are at now. It was the beginning. Now you're in this position and you don't know how to come out of it. You don't know how to come out of it because you're trying to bring all of us out of it. You can't bring all of us out of it. You have to learn who it is that's supposed to come out of it. And you have to be content with that. I want to play something for you because I'm also trying to get you to understand talking points. These talking points are the things that put us in this predicament, and these talking points are the things that keep us in this predicament. It happened way back yonder, yonder, and it's happening now. I keep telling you, 2020, hindsight is 2020, and this is the year of 2020. This is the year of reflection. Let me play this for you so you can hear this adult male, who's famous, by the way, say what he say, and I need you to take your time and understand if you have a relative, a mother, a father, a sister or brother, a son or daughter, a niece or a nephew, a principal, a school teacher, a firefighter, a military personnel, a secretary, a receptionist, a mechanic. If they speak this speak, you just learned what they did to you. Let me play it.
No Gucci, no partner of Gucci. I grew up in the 60s. What I've learned watching the civil rights movement of the 60s, that the most important thing that a person of color can do is to get inside, to have a seat at the table. That is the most important reason for me taking that deal.
I need you to understand what this man just said. I grew up in the 60s, and what I learned at that time is the most important thing that you can do is to get in on the inside, is to have a seat at the table. The gentleman is a fashion designer. And in his heyday, he was, you know, designing clothes for black folks. But he was having a rough go at things. And because he was having a rough go at things, he decided to cut some corners. When he decided to cut corners, he started using other people's logos. When he started using other people's logos, those other people propositioned him. And when they propositioned him, as always, they gave him I give you an option you can't refuse. He couldn't refuse it. So he's saying that the most important thing is to have a seat at the table. When they speak like that, you ask yourself immediately, why do you want to sit at their table versus having a table of your own? When your relatives talk that way, ask yourself immediately, why can't we do our own thing? Why do we always got to go through them? It's coward talk. I'm not blaming him. But unfortunately, I did the research. He is a baby boomer. And I'm telling you now, you baby boomers, and we're all saying it. We are all saying it. You baby boomers, black or white, Hispanic, Puerto Rican, or Asian, all of you, you failed us the absolute most. Nobody talks ill about that war era. The First World War era generation. Nobody speaks ill of them. Nobody speaks ill in a disrespectful manner, in a blaming manner of that generation that came up out of the Depression. 20s. Roaring 20s. Nobody speaks ill of them. Nobody speaks ill of 1900s. Nobody speaks ill of the 1800s. We were dealing with racism itself. But we weren't speaking ill of our people. We didn't start speaking ill of our people, not until integration. Once we integrated in the 60s, that's when we started speaking ill of you baby boomers. Because you guys are not understanding what meant more to you as opposed to what meant more to the nation. No, we weren't selling drugs to ourselves at the capacity it was to you baby boomers. You baby boomers sold a shit ton of drugs to your own kind between the years of the 60s and the 90s. The 60s, 70s, 80s, and the 90s. It's 40 years. Now you're here with 2000 and 2020. That's another additional 20 years. You guys have destroyed us because of that sentiment this man just said. Having a seat at the table. Now you want to sit up here and say, well, every generation blames a generation before it for what it did or didn't do. I mean, your statement is right. Because you didn't do your job. But nobody has destroyed us the way that you baby boomers participated in our destruction. Family, like I always say, I want to keep it tight and I want to keep it right. I want to keep it short and I want to keep it condensed. coward talk. What it is, how it works, and why is it spoken? Please understand, I try to do it the long way so that you can have a better detailed understanding. I'm not going to sit up here and try to say this word versus that word. That I looked up one word one day and it had 20 associated words that all imply, infer, insist the exact same thing. You need to understand what I just showed you. You need to understand that way back yonder, our ancestors was doing something specific that was unique to them. And when the outsiders started to realize that what's happening to them is not the same as what's happening to them, what they did is they said, I want some of that. But when they got here, or when they got in there, they didn't want to abide by all the rules. They didn't want to stop eating shrimp. They didn't want to stop eating shell food. They didn't want to stop wearing the clothes or start wearing the clothes. It depends on that era, but what I'm saying is they didn't want to do all the things that was associated to the success of the purpose of why they decided to say, how come they're living better than us? There's a reason why one group was better than the other group. There's a reason that one group was doing certain things. And when that one group was doing certain things, it benefited that group. That was it. It benefited that group. It does not benefit everyone else. So even if they do it, doesn't benefit you. So now you're just being symbolic. Well, I'm doing it, but I don't get nothing out of it. Doesn't benefit you. Family, listen. There are people who are amongst us that are not of us. And you have to learn how to smoke them out. When that person speaks, it's better to get a seat at the table. You must understand that person is a coward on sight. There is no room for reinterpretation. Well, that's not what I meant. Well, what I meant to say was, what I'm getting at is, yo, get out, get away. You don't let that person say what that person just said and then continue to have a profound discussion. You go, yeah, okay, see ya. This is how we're in this predicament. And we can't get out of it because you don't know the talking points. Say, I'm going to make another video about Ice Cube. And I'm going to explain, I've been putting these things on Facebook. And I've been trying to show you guys how we are double talking. And I've been trying to show you guys that there's a gender that is at war with another gender in the Black nation. There is a gender that is at war with another gender within the Black nation. You guys got to be able to learn what gender is at war with the other gender. One of the genders is a victim gender. The other gender is a perpetuator of war on that victimized gender. You have to do, that's a different topic. That's not associated to this topic. I got lessons on top of lessons on top of lessons. What I'm saying is, if you're not able to determine individual talking points, what they are, what they ought to be, then you're not going to be able to determine how to get yourself out of it. You cannot get yourself out of this by marrying out of your race. You cannot. But what you can do by marrying out of your race is make your particular suffrage or hardship, your bondage, more tolerable. But you're not coming out of it because of it. You cannot come out of this by having sex with multiple women. But what you can do by having sex with multiple women is make your particular suffrage more bearable. But you're not coming out of it. You cannot come out of this by having sex with multiple men. But what you can do by having sex with multiple men is make your suffrage, your bondage, more tolerable. But it does not bring you out of this. You're not coming out of this because you make a bunch of rap songs with all nationalities, all nations. But what you can do is make a bunch of rap songs with a bunch of nationalities, a bunch of nations, a bunch of genders, make your bondage, your suffrage, more enjoyable. But it does not bring you out of it. There's only one thing that brings you out of it. And you know what that one thing is. And that's the reason why you're not coming out of it. You put your faith in me. You put your faith in men and women like me as a collective, not a single. I'm not a Christ. I'm not a Messiah, and I'm not a messenger. But I'm going to tell you, I have the antidote. And if you think another 6,000 years of cohabitating with other nations, if you think another 8,000 years of cohabitating and having offspring in sex with other nations is going to be what brings this world a place of unity and paradise. Remember, you guys are Christians. So you're supposed to be moving in the manner and the direction of Christ, paradise on earth. You guys are stupid. Well, look, you guys are stupid. I'm the dropout. Well, I ain't dropout. I graduated. But I graduated. I was 21 when I graduated. 21? I think I was 20, turning 21. Yeah. I was 20, turning 21. I was 20 when I graduated. And if I'm that dumb, and I was a kid that was a resource. I was the kid that had special ed. And if the dummy can figure it out, then you people that got those 4.0s, you people that got those 3.0s, you're supposed to be smarter than me. You're supposed to understand it faster, quicker than me. So either you do or you don't. And we don't care if you do, as long as you do what you're supposed to do. We care if you don't. Because if you don't, that means you won't. And if you won't, that means you will do the other that will cause me more and greater harm. There's only one way out of this. And if you got 6,000 years, I keep telling you, I'm reading this book called The Destruction of the Black Civilization. And in that book, he got a date, 3100 BC. And if he got a date, that's 3100 BC. Some say BC is before Common Era. Some say BC is before Christ. At the end of the day, listen. If he says 3100 BC, where you were mixing with the Asiatics, you were mixing with the European Egyptians, and you were suffering then, how the hell do you think by mixing with all these other nations now in 2020 is going to get you any way up out of any kind of bondage and suffrage? Slavery. That is not the thing that gets you out. That is the thing that gets you in, and that is the thing that keeps you in. One of my great elders, she's an ancestor now, Dr. Frances Cress Welsin, genetic annihilation. She explains that white women having sex with black men causes more harm and causes more danger than not having sex or having interracial relationships does. And then she goes on to explain it her way. Now, I'm going to give it to you quickly. When you have other nationalities in a relationship with a nationality or nation that is in bondage or slavery or subjected to the evil that that nation produces upon the nation that is in slavery or bondage or subjected to, what it does is it convinces the others that are slaves, that are in bondage, that are in suffrage, that if they can get a person of the opposite sex that is in, that is putting them in slavery or some form of bondage or suffrage, it convinces them that the system that they're in really is not that bad of a system. All they got to do is get a white girl or a white boy or Hispanic or a Caribbean or whatever, because it depends. What I'm saying is dating outside of your race. That's all I'm saying. What it does is it convinces those that are in bondage that it's not really that bad. And all you got to do is get one of them. And if you get one of them, then for the most part, life is easier. And then she goes on to explain a lot of things. But you already know it doesn't make life, it doesn't get us out of this. You got biracial children right now running around and they don't know which side of the fence to go on. They don't know if they should support their Puerto Rican mom or should support their African father. They don't know if they should support their Guyanese father or should they support their white Anglo-Saxon mother. They're in turmoil right now. Because you got them at two different sides of the fence, and these are nations that are fighting. These aren't people that are fighting. These are nations that are fighting. And you're putting these children in the middle of it. And these children don't know which way to go. I told you before, they have nowhere to go. They're going to choose the side that gives them the least amount of resistance. If white folks accept them with open arms, they're going. If black folks accept them with open arms, they're coming. They have nowhere to go. And they know that. It ain't about what they say, it's about what they know. And they know one of them is going to reject them. So they're going to go to the side that does the least amount of rejection. Y'all know what I'm saying. This whole video was to show you how a living individual who comes from the 60s said what he said, and that being on the inside, having a seat at the table, was where it is at. That is the way you slaves think. Now you better understand why you think Nick Cannon should have shut his mouth. Now you better understand why you're having an issue with Ice Cube. I have a different issue with Ice Cube. My issue with Ice Cube is not the same as yours. My issue is totally different. Your issue with Ice Cube is, whatever it is different. I'm in this video because I want to keep it tight. Coward talk. What it is, how it sounds, and it should never be spoken. You grind hard. You take as long as it takes to have your own. You stop thinking that their ice is better. Their ice is colder. You stop thinking that they're the way out. They are not the way out. They are exploiting you. They are taking your stuff, going wherever they go, remix it, come back and give it to you. You are not supposed to be mingling with them. And you have to realize that these are genetic markers. And what you're going to realize is that it takes time to study and it takes time to learn. If I say it right now, it'll be over your head. You're not ready. You got to come to class a little bit more. You're going to learn that there are those amongst us, but they are not us. Even though they look like us and they have our phenotype, they are not us. They are the others. And they're more inclined to do what the enemy says. And that's not fear. It looks like fear. Oh, you're afraid, so you do it out of fear. It looks like fear, but it's not fear. They are more inclined to do what the enemy says because they themselves feel the exact same way, because it's not theirs. You don't protect someone else's stuff the way you would protect your own. You may protect it, but there's a certain line you're not going to cross. But when it's your own, there's almost no line you won't cross because it's yours. You, when they speak this spoke, they just showed you they are not you. And if they are not you, remove yourself from amongst them. Stop talking. Warrior class, Zoo, rise up. Warrior class, Zoo, stand up. Warrior class, Zoo, show up. As always, peace and black power.